الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وحبيب رب العالمين، وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين، ورضي الله عن أصحابه أجمعين، وعنا معهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. العلماء الكرام الحاضرين، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Before I begin, I'm indeed humbled by the Sheikh, brother who introduced me, which I am not worthy of all this praise he gave me. But may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive me. But I do feel home. First, I come from Masjid al-Madinah and I land in Masjid al-Madinah. So, and may Allah gather us all in Medina. Because we have a love in our heart for the one who lit the Medina. For his name, Al-Madina became Medina. And without him, there would have been no Medina. And so we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put the nur of Medina in our heart. Just like Bulbul in Medina was sitting here. Where is he? MashaAllah. He's like the Bulbul of Medina. He says all these praises in the praise of the maqam of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So may Allah give us this yearning and show to go to Medina. Today we are going to Medina, inshallah, with our hearts, with our souls. So please direct your compass, whatever your compass is, direct your compass to Al-Qubbatul Khadra. So we can get some anwar. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in us first the nur of his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then this way, then we can talk about the azamat al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For if there is no tawfiq, there is no way somebody can talk about the azamah of the Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what we're talking about today, I know that the subject is Isra and Mi'raj. But not only Isra and Mi'raj, the purpose of Isra and Mi'raj is what? To show the azama of the Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the whole Quran is to show the azama of Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Almost every ayah in the Quran tells you how great al-Habib al-Azam, wal-Nabiyu al-Afqam, wal-Nur al-Mujassam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is how it is really, I mean, this is the fact. So don't be shy, I always remind myself. You know, I repeat myself, so don't take me too serious sometimes. But don't be shy if you hear the name of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, somebody you all love. You hear his name, don't be shy to say it loudly, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Even if you interrupt me all the time, it's okay. Now, and the whole purpose is what? We are gathered here to make dhikr of Allah and to praise his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Really, that's the whole thing. And this is the result and the zubda, the butter of the whole majlis. Let's start with the book of Allah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Subhanalladhi asra bi'abdi laylan min al-masjid al-haram ila al-masjid al-aqsa alladhi barakna hawlah. The meaning of the one of the ayah of Surah Isra, Allah begins the ayah with Subhana, tasbih. Tasbih means tanzih. Tanzih is ta'zim. That nothing is like him. Ta'ala amma yasifun. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Subhanallah. When you are in your salah, when you do subhanallah, what does that mean? Subhana rabbi al-azim, subhana rabbi al-a'la. All you say ta'zim of Allah Jalla Jalaluhu, that nothing is like him. He is the creator. Everything else is the creation. He is the Lord, worthy of worship. And nothing else is worthy of worship but him, Allahu Rabbul Alameen. This is Subhan. One word. Among the ijaz of the Quran. Al-Quran, mu'jizat, right? Every word there's something meaning. Actually, every word is like oceans of knowledge. Allah says one with Subhan, another ayah, he starts, Yusabbihu lillah. Sabbaha lillah. Different way.
What is Qur'an?
La, the whole salah that we do has tashbih in it. Three times ruku', three times sujood, then you do ruku'. Ajeeb. The whole salah is to praise Rabbul Alameen. Tashbih. Subhanallah. The Lord of the world. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alladhi asra bi'abdihi. The one who did isra, took his abd, slave. من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله. To المسجد الأقصى that we have blessed its surrounding. Keep that, not in mind. Why? What is the purpose of this? Is the itinerary.
Before you go on a trip, on a journey, they give you itinerary, صحيح؟ يعني you go this. This is the itinerary.
What is the purpose of the journey? Allah says, لنريه من آياتنا. So we can show al-Habib, al-Nabi al-A'zam. So we can show him, Allah has mentioned, لنريه, which means, so we can show him some of our glorious creation. I want to stop at the ayah, just at the beginning, and then we will go on a little bit. Notice Allah says, سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده. He didn't say برسوله. Abd means slave, Rasul, messenger. Some of the Ahl al-Ilm said, wait a minute now. Which one is higher? Being a Abd of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or being a Rasul of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? But wait a minute. Aren't we all Ibadullah? Aren't we all the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Indeed, we all are because we all are created by Allah. لكن when Allah says, وعباد الرحمن, the عباد of الرحمن, that's not everybody. That's for أولياء الله الصالحين. When Allah says, إن عبادي ليس لك عليهم سلطان. My, it's like شيطان. My عباد, my slaves, you have no access to them. Which means who? The أولياء of Allah. And the best أولياء of Allah are the أنبياء of Allah. And the best of the أنبياء are أولي العزم. The five of the messengers, and the best of the five of the messengers, Muhammadun Rasulullah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So therefore, al-ubudiyya, tahqiq, the real, being a real slave of Allah, that is the highest maqam any creation can ever attain. You testify, all of you know. For salam. التحيات. Look at what you say. You say التحيات لله والصلوات etc. And then you say أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا before رسول. What do you say? You don't say وأشهد أن محمدا رسوله وعبده. لا. You say وأشهد أن محمدا عبده. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده. Then you say ورسوله. لأنه هو العبد الحقيقي. تحقيق العبودية كانت النبي الأعظم صلى الله تعالى عليه وآله وسلم. He was a true slave of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. Hence Allah says أليس الله بكاف عبده. Isn't Allah enough? The meaning of the ayah. Isn't Allah enough for his slave? The Quran asks this question. We are all slaves of Allah. How come some people are not satisfied with what Allah gives them? The reason is they do not have the tahqiq of the ubudiyya. They haven't realized the real being slave to Allah. Who have realized that? The awliya of Allah. I'll give you this, and you know that, this event. Our grandfather, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kalim. Imam al-Kalim, كبار أئمة أهل السنة. His father, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, the Ustad of Imam al-A'zam Abi Hanifa al-Nu'man رضي الله تعالى عنه. So much of Imam Abu Hanifa says, لولا السنتان لهلك النعمان. If it wasn't for the 2 years, النعمان Abu Hanifa would have perished. This is Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, his son of Imam al-Kadhar. One time he's walking in Baghdad. Imam al-Kadhar is walking in Baghdad. At the before Fajr time, going to the masjid to pray. Huh? Well, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, by the way, for those of you who don't know Imam Musa. Imam Musa was a very thin, very dark colored Arab. The Arabs vary in color and pigmentation, but he was very dark almost. Walking at the end of the night, going to the masjid, he sees a jariya, maid, coming out of the house. In the house, party time inside the house. Noises and people making party, music, dancing appears like things going on, and she's coming out of the house with a tray, big tray, filled with food. She's taking it to the rubbish. At the end of the, you know, some people at the night they pray, and some people they play. Huh? Some people, they take the night time to pray. And some will talk about that in just a minute. Some people take that time to play. Like Imam Musa is going to the masjid and he sees this jariya coming out. You can tell she's a jariya. He says he sees her throwing the food away. Food is not almost touched. He says, Ya jariya, asayyiduki hurran am abd. Says, oh maid, is your master free or is he a slave? She looks at him. What's wrong with this man? And he's asking, he knows I'm a maid. And he's asking me, he says, Ya jariya, oh maid, so he knows I'm a maid. And then he asks me if my master is free or a slave. I look at him and said, of course he is free. He's a master. He looked at him and says, you are right. For if he was a slave to Allah, he would have feared Allah what he's doing. She ran inside the house. She didn't know what to do. The haybah, the jalal of the imam overtook her. She went running inside the house to the master. You know the master's name? I'll tell you his name. She told him, I'm taking this to throw it. And this dark man comes and tells me these words, and I'm shaking by his words. The nur is coming. He's black, but the nur is coming out of his face. He's dark, but the nur is coming out of his face. And I couldn't reply to him, and I don't know what these words mean. He said that if you are a true slave, you would have feared Allah. This man was standing with the people that are partying with him, and he was shook by the words. He ran after, he says, where did he go? She said, that way. He ran after him barefoot. Hafi. Hafi in the Arabic language means barefoot. The name of the person is Bishr. Bishr al? Bishr al Hafi. Bishr the barefoot. From that day, he ran after Imam al-Kadhim. Where is that man who said this? Ran after him until he saw him in the masjid. He made tawbah from that day on. He became a pious wali of Allah. And they called him Bishr, the barefoot. From that day on, he said, I'm going to only go barefoot. Who is the real abd of Allah? The awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who is the best wali of Allah? Al-Nabiyyul A'zam is the highest. A'zam waliyunillah. سبحانه صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وسلم. هذا سبحان الذي أسرى. لكن let me just take you historically speaking. Before الإسراء والمعراج, the event of الإسراء والمعراج, you all know. Right before الإسراء والمعراج, النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم was the Taif. He went to a Taif. What did he do at Taif? To call the people to Allah. What did they do to him? Pelted him. Threw stones at him, threw filth at him, in the narration there is a khabar, comes and it's authentic, where Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam runs to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, rushes for Taif, after they do these things to him, and his feet bleed sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he's bleeding, and all this torture and hardship, and Jibreel does an emergency landing. Right away, running to the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, says, Ya Rasulullah, I did not come alone. I came with me the angel who is in charge of the mountains. All of a sudden, there's an angel, Malakul Jibal. Ya Rasulullah, I am at your order. You tell me what to do, and I will close, destroy all the mountains on these people's heads. Huh? At your order, let me know. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Prophet says, oh Allah, give people guidance for they do not know. Give them guidance for they do not know. He tells him, Ya Jibreel, I was sent as a mercy. I was not sent as a punishment. After these things that happened to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah wants to honor him. Allah wants to honor him. So, what does Allah do to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He takes him on this journey of Isra and Mi'raj. To do takreem. If, in other words, as if the Quran is telling you, if this is how the people will treat you, Ya Rasulullah, then come and welcome to our treat instead. If they don't appreciate your value, we appreciate who you are. If they treat you this way on earth, let welcome to the people of heaven. See how the malaika will treat you, Ya Rasulullah. لِنُرِيَهُ مِنْ آيَاتِهِ. No, if they don't understand who you are, come. Come. وَاسْجُدْ وَاقْتَرِبْ. Get close. طيب. This is among the things that we have to look for. تكريم. Some people may ask themselves, and maybe you should ask yourself, say, how come? يعني, why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want to do تكريم with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم after he subjects him to the people of Al-Taif? Why doesn't he do تكريم of him without going to Al-Taif? Without having been subjugated to the punishment and the slandering of these people and etc. etc. Why can't we just honor him and that's it? Because he needs to teach us that الدعوه الى الله requires suffering. الدعوه to Allah requires hardships. الدعوه to Allah requires sacrifice. When you make da'wah to Allah, you will be slandered. When you make da'wah to Allah, you will be tortured. When you make da'wah to Allah, you will have difficulties and you will have hardships and people will say all these things about you. But you have to keep going because you are doing this not for you but for Allah Rabbul Alameen. And you are not better than Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who he himself had to suffer so he can show you the way. But then you work and work, and that work may bring results. But wait, if results come, don't think it's because you are smart. Don't think it's because you are so special. Don't think it's because you are the one who made it. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وَمَا رَمَيْتَ إِذْ رَمَيْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ رَمَى. You did not do it, but Allah did it for you. Allah is the one who does it for you. But you have to do the effort. You have to go and undergo the hardships. You have to undergo the difficulties. You have to hold steady on the Quran and the authentic Sunnah. And the result is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gives you. If he gave you, then it's because of his generosity. And if he did not give you, it's because of his justice. وَمَا رَمَيْتَ إِذْ رَمَيْتَ. Abadan, it's not you who threw, لكن الله. Let's go to the ayah. سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا. The ayah says ليلا. ليلا means the Isra was at night. At night time. What happens at night time? I'm going to talk about the Isra from a different angle because I know you know all the other major things. So I'm going to try to shed light on other things that are usually not shed upon. What happens during the night? The people of plague and the people of prey. At night, laylan. Some people waste their time on television. Some people waste their time at night gatherings and backbiting and sitting and talking. Some people have different kind of gatherings at night. Some people do bad things at night. Some people sin and disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at night. Some people commit fusuq at night. That's what some people do. But then at night, laylan. Why does Allah here emphasize the point night? Because look at the Quran. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنَا وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. Remember, سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ. The abd, the slave of Allah, the true slave of Allah. Who are they? The ibadu al-Rahman, the awliya al-Rahman. In the other ayah, Allah says, وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ. The awliya. slaves of Allah. What is their characteristics, Ya Allah? What's their description?
During the day, they are walking on with ease on earth. When al-jahilun talk to them, they say salama. What do they do at night? وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ نِيَامًا لَا وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ سُجَّدًا وَقِيَامًا. They don't spend the night نِيَامًا sleeping. لَا they, وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ they spend the night سُجَّدًا وَقِيَامًا. They're doing sujood and qiyam their whole night. The night of the awliya is qiyam and sujood and ruku', not niyam, sleeping. I'm not talking about those who waste it in the other way. I'm talking about those who sleep those nights. The hadith of Sahihain, the authentic hadith where Nabi Alam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Allah in the third night, the third end of part of the night, He sends angels to ask it to the heavens, for the earthly heavens, to ask people on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does anyone have any mas'ala that he needs so I can give him? Does anyone want, seeks my forgiveness so I can forgive him? Does anyone have anything that to ask of me so I can grant him? هل من سائل فأعطيه؟ هل من مستغفر فأغفر له؟ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us at the end of the night, this is what He tells, He asks of us, if you have a mas'ala, if you have a need, if you have something that you want to ask, that's when you ask at the third night, at the third end of the night. فِي الْقِيَامِ وَأَنْ صَلَاتُ اللَّهِ subhanahu wa ta'ala سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ لَيْلًا. Laylan at night. So to emphasize the point at night, so much that the Nabi al-Azam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was making qiyam salat al-hajjud the whole night. Every single night he would do that until Allah revealed, قُمِ اللَّيْلَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قُمِ اللَّيْلَ. Yes, do the hajjud the whole night, except just a little, sleep just a little. إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. قُمِ اللَّيْلَ. At the night you should stay up and make salat and stay in the hajjud and qiyam and dhikr to Allah. But some part of the night sleep. I'm talking to each to ourselves. What part of the night do we sleep? And what part of the night do we do the hajjud and qiyam to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How much of the night do we dedicate and devote to making dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks the malaika to tell us, and He tells us subhanahu wa ta'ala, if there is anyone who wants this maghfirah so I can forgive him, are we asking him maghfirah at that time? Are we asking him our hajat and our needs at the end of the night? We have to ask ourselves this. I'm not saying those who don't wake up at all, I'm saying where do you wake up and how much? Layla. Though you all know this, that the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een, they asked Nabi al-Azam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, Ya Rasulullah, how is your sleep at night? He told them, Al-Anbiya, if their eyes sleep, their heart never sleeps. Al-Anbiya, إِذَا نَامَتْ عُيُونُهُمْ لَا تَنَامُ قُلُوبُهُمْ. Their hearts never sleep. They're in continuous dhikr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether they appear asleep in front of you or they're not, they're always awake and present. Of course. We all know that, right? And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was doing his siyam, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they wanted to do siyam. He said, no, I'm not like you. Hadith sahih, Imam Bukhari, please. He said, I'm not like one of you. I stay with my Lord. He gives me food and drinks. You know. Yani what kind of food, what kind of drinks? Only Allah knows and His Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have no business to interfere. Lakin we have nisbah, Ya Rasulullah. We have nisbah to you, Ya Rasulullah. We want to be attached to you, so maybe we can taste some of that sweetness through you. Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa ala ashabihi wa ahbabihi wa azwajihi wa dhurriyatihi ajma'in. Allah. صلوا على رسول الله. بلى.
بكماله كشف الدجى بجمال. علم السعدي رحمة الله عليه. From that time, some people they say words of wisdom like this. كشف العلا بلغ العلا بجماله كشف الدجى بجمال. This beauty, صلى الله عليه وسلم. حسنت جميع خصاله. Every single aspect in him, صلى الله عليه وسلم, is great and beautiful. صلوا عليه وآله. سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلاً. العبد, now we know who is the true عبد of Allah. فأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. ورسول comes after. Number two. عبده. Then, ليلاً. So we know what is the night. Why night? So we take lessons. Al-Isra, this ayah of Isra, wallah, this only ayah of Isra has so many secrets, we can talk about it from here till tomorrow. And you can deduce from every word so many different, from the word Subhan, we have lectures at Tawheed for 3 days. Wallahi, from this word, I swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and from this word Subhan, you can write books. Lakin, layla. And the صلى الله عليه وسلم says hadith Bukhari, by the way, صحيح. He says, I was in the house of Umm Hanik. You know who Umm Hanik is? Umm Hanik, the ulama, they disagree on her name, Atika wa Fakhita, Bintu Abi Talib. She is the sister of Sayyidina Amir al-Mu'minin Ali ibn Abi Talib. Umm Hanik, she is the sister of Ali, and she is the daughter of Abu Talib. Sahabiya رضي الله تعالى عنها. النبي الأعظم صلى الله عليه وسلم was in Mecca. In her home, he says, فشق السقف, the ceiling split, and Jibreel came to me in the middle of the night. Says, قم يا رسول الله, يا رسول الله, please stand. Where are we going? He says, all of a sudden, he takes my hand, and then we go into al-Buraq. Al-Buraq is what? Al-Buraq, he says, it's a dabba. Dabba means it's an animal, looks like an animal, higher than the donkey and lower than the mule. So between the donkey and the mule, and we ride, it's what colored in white, abyad, dabbatun bayda. I take it, I ride on al-Buraq, and we go from al-Masjid Haram, wait, before from the Masjid Haram, he says, Jibreel takes my hand, and we make tawaf around Baytullah al-Haram. First we do tawaf around the Kaaba. To show us the emphasis. Where is our heart? And where are our eyes? And where are these things? First we do tawaf, and then he brings al-Buraq, and we ride al-Buraq from al-Bayt al-Haram ila al-Masjid al-Aqsa. For Quds, in the Masjid al-Aqsa, and then the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, after we got to al-Quds, I tied al-Buraq, like someone ties his horse, on the halaqa. On that circle that is stuck in the wall. You know which wall is this? The wailing wall. That's where the little circle, the metal circle, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tied al-Buraq there. Now some people, and again I'm trying to explain the Isra wal Mi'raj from a different angle. Now some people may ask themselves, why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give him al-Buraq? Why doesn't simply he close his eyes and open his eyes and he's in Bayt al-Maqdis? What's right away like this? There's no need. Does Allah need to send al-Buraq? No. Can he will for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be in a split second from one point to another? Sure. But why? To teach you to take reasons. Take reasons for things. Seek reasons to get to where you want. There is wasila there. Is it opening our minds? There is what? Yes, al-Buraq makhluk. Al-Buraq makhluk. It's a makhluk to Allah. What Nabi al-Azam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a better, higher makhluk and the best of the creation. Yet al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam seeks this wasila, this reason, so he can reach there. So to tell you that, yes, when you are doing something, when you seek your rizq, go and work. Allah will give you, but you're supposed to go and work. When you are doing da'wah, go and struggle. Allah will give you tawfiq, but you're supposed to struggle. Seek the reasons, seek the wasila all the time. That's the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
البراق. And not only that, he ties al buraq. Ties it to that circle, to that little thing there on the wall. So he does it. Shows you that you have to do it right. Take care of it. Do it in the right way. Because this is how al-Nabiyul A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did it. Yes, al-shifa is from who? Allah. Allah is the one who gives you the cure. Lakin you are ordered to go to who? To the doctor. Now, before you go to the doctor, you say, oh Allah, I ask you shifa. And you go, you seek the help of the doctor. Are you committing shirk here? No. Huh? The doctor is Muslim. You know and you believe that the shifa is not in the hands of the doctor. But the doctor is wasila that Allah created and made for you to seek cure. And you can compare now. And we don't have a lot of time to talk about everything. First al-buraq, after al-buraq, al-Nabi al-A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after he touched al-buraq, في المسجد الأقصى, he goes, all of a sudden, a big surprise. Huh? What is the surprise? All the anbiya min ladun Adam. From Adam alayhi salam, all the anbiya are gathered waiting for his reception. It's a big surprise. What is this, Ya Jibreel? He says, these are the anbiya from the time of Adam alayhi salam. Now, I'm not going to go by this lightly. Again, like I told you, I'm going to try to explain things that people usually pass. What does that mean? The anbiya were all gathered and he was their imam. But before even he became their imam and then he came and he saw them. He is the imam and he is the imam. Imam means the front and imam means the leader. Why? Because he is our imam in the dunya and he is in front of us for al-akhirah wa al-jannah. He is the one whose the doors of jannah will open for him and the ummah follows him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he is imam in the front and he is the imam. But not only that, another ishara. Ishara. Symbol, sign. Al-anbiya from Adam. Subhanallah. What does that mean? Every Nabi, every Prophet represents his era and his time and the place. Sahih? Yani every Nabi, alayhi salam, every Prophet from Adam, Adam represents the whole earth. Other Anbiya represents different time and different places. Sahih? Now, let me ask you this. They're all gathered and he prayed their imam. I want to ask you now a question in fiqh. If you have guests that come to your house, the sunnah says who should be the imam? The owner of the house or the guest? The owner of the house? The owner of the house? The sunnah is that the owner of the house is the imam. Sahih? The guest simply becomes the muqtadi. And the owner of the house becomes the imam. That's the sunnah, unless the owner of the house allows you to. لا يؤمر رجل في بيته. Hadith, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says that the man cannot be led in his own house. In his house, he's the imam. Unless he asks you to do it. Is it ringing or not? When Nabi Al-A'zam Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came and all the anbiya were gathered in the house. And then he was the imam as if they're giving him the leadership of the dunya. Because all these prophets are prophets and leaders and imams of their time and places. And now al-Nabi al-A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the imam of the worlds, of al-kawn, of the universe. And all of them are being led by him, giving him the leadership, submitting to him, showing him and putting him in his place that Allah put him in as the leader and the mercy and the role model of the entire universe, including the anbiya who are leaders themselves. Wow. You are now. The whole world is in your hand, Ya Rasulullah. That's the Imam. We have to think about these things. Sometimes, huh? Because now he is like the owner of the house. See what I'm saying? The owner of the house is the one who leads. So he is the owner of the house. If the anbiya are anbiya of different places and different nations, so he is the owner of the different places and the different nations because he is Rasul Rabbil Alameen. To everything. Lil Alameen.
So he leads them. And praise God, etc. You all know. And after that, of course, the journey of ascension to Al-Mi'raj. Of course, Al-Mi'raj has a special things attached to it. Huh? And in Al-Mi'raj, what happens? Jibreel alayhi salam goes through the first heaven. You all know about the Hadith al-Bukhari, Muslim. And I don't want to go into too much details because then it will take us a long time. Lakin, Jibreel comes, knocks the door. Heavens have doors? Yeah, of course. Who is this? This is Jibreel. Who is with you? This is Muhammad. Allah usila ilayh. Is it his time that he sent him? Naam. Jibreel Aisab says yes. They open. And Malaika, then after they open the first heavens, the first level of heaven, they gather and Malaika line after line to receive Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Happy for his reception, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alayhi wa sallam. And welcoming him to heavens, the first heaven. I'm telling you this, and I know you all know this, but I want to see how happy are you for receiving Rasulullah every day. Every day when the Mu'adhan says, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, you are receiving the mercy of Rasulullah. How happy are you? Do you display your pleasure? Do you display your happiness? Do you feel that you are close to him? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the first heaven. Who does he see? He sees a man, Isra'ula. And this man, he looks on his right and he laughs. And he looks on his left and he cries. Sayyidina Nabeel Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asks Jibreel, he says, Ya Jibreel, who is this? He says, this is Adam alayhi salam. He is looking at the people of Jannah on his right and he laughs. And he looks at the people of Jahannam on his left and he cries. The people of Jannah, the people of Ahlul Yameen, Ashab al Yameen, wa Ashab al Shimal. Ma Asmadraka, ma Ashab al Yameen. Then you all know Ashab al Shimal, the people of the left. Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam is crying on these people who are going to Jahannam because of what he sees. Walayyatu billah of Jahannam. Then when he realized the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is there, he says, مَرْحَبًا بِالنَّبِيِّ الصَّالِحِ وَالْإِبْنِ الصَّالِحِ. Welcome of the pious Prophet and the pious son. Salih. Huh? Pious. And that's a beauty. Anyway, Jibreel alayhi wa sallam takes him to the second heaven and also knocks. Who is this, Jibreel? Who's with you? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah قَدْ أُرْسِلَ إِلَيْهِ وَعِثَ إِلَيْهِ وَسَّلْتُ him. Yes. You see the point here or don't you see the point? There is nimam. There is system. Things have a system. When we approach, we want to go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is a path. There is a way. There is a system. It's not chaotic. It's not left like this. There is a protocol. There are ways. There are wasilas. There are methodologies. There is manhaj, there is maslak, there are things that you have to do in order for you to reach. You don't just go there. There is a knocking of some doors. And the biggest door that you can knock is the door of the love of Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But there is another thing I want you to also think about from an ihsan point of view. Permission. Permission. Hatta Jibreel, he's teaching us what? Take permission. Knocking the door on the heavens. Who is this? This is Jibreel. In other words, implicitly, do you allow me to come in? There is permission there. He's teaching us akhlaq. He's teaching us morality. He's teaching us how to be polite, how to have the understanding of etiquettes. Therefore, al-Nabi al-A'lam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Seek permission. Seek permission of your shuyukh. Seek permission of people anyway. People, this is the deen is akhlaq. The deen is etiquettes. The deen is when you show that you actually are a learner from the madrasa of Muhammadun Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He goes into the second heaven. Who doesn't he see in the second heaven? Yahya wa Isa alayhi wa sallam. Ajib. You should be asking, I know some of you are probably asking themselves, how come in the second heaven there is Yahya
وعيسى. What's going on here? You know, in the dunya they were close. So in the heavens they are close. Subhanallah. In the dunya they were close because they are cousins. يعني وعيسى they're cousins. And in the akhirah or في السماء في ال in the heavens في السماوات they're also close in the second heaven.
That is, there is ishara in this. You know what's ishara? If I can take you, I can take you in and I'll tell you about what happened في Uhud. You know in the battle of Uhud, and Nabi al-Azam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was very sad because he lost lots of sahaba kiram who were in the night. So they used to bury them together sometime. And then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, where is Amr ibn al-Jamuh? Where's Abdullah ibn Haram? They're both martyred. They said, why, Rasulullah? Why are you asking about these two people? He said, bury them together because they used to be loving each other in the path of Allah when they were alive. Look, your soul, you love someone for dunya, Allah puts you close to him for the akhirah. Imagine if you love Rasulullah. Maybe, then maybe your soul will be close to his soul, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, and his faith, al-faith al-Muhammadi, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, in the dunya and in the akhirah. Only if you, because those are, you will be with those you love. And hadith sahih, where Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, al-arwahu junudun mujannada. The souls are like soldiers. Ma ta'arafa minha talaf, wa ma tanakara ikhtalaf. Those souls who love each other will be close together. Isa wa Yahya fi dunya, they were close, Allah put them in the same heaven. Wa Amr ibn al-Jamuh, Abdullah ibn al-Haram, they were close in dunya, Allah buried them together, hatta fi al-barzakh. Does that mean, do I have to spell everything out? Or do I have, you know already? As-Siddiq al-Akbar, radiyallahu ta'ala. I see some faces smiling. سيدنا عمر الفاروق أبو حفص رضي الله تعالى عنه. In the dunya they were always with Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And in the akhirah with Rasulullah. And even in the barzakh with Rasulullah.
سبحان الله
حتى even in the قبة الخضراء في الروضة الشريفة سيدنا الصديق رضي الله عنه could not leave his beloved. Do you see what I'm trying to say? When you love somebody, Allah will give tawfiq for you to be with him. We don't have... I'm not going to say everything because you know the rest of this stuff, but just little points here and there only. Just to provoke the mind to start thinking. This is the first thing. Sayyidina Isa wa Yahya, they say, Marhaban bin Nabi al-Salih wal-Akhi al-Salih. Welcome, the pious prophet. And the pious brother. Look at Islam. Please, look at this. Look at our Islam. How beautiful Islam is. Look, we love all the prophets. Isa, we love him, alayhi salam. Yahya, we love him, alayhi salam. Musa, we love him. Al-Akhi Salih, Al-Ibn Salih, Al-Nabi Salih, Al-Ibn Salih. La nufarritu bayna ahadin min rasulih. We love all the, some other people, they differentiate between the prophets. They love some prophet and our prophet. They don't love our prophet. But the Ummah of Rasulullah, we love everybody. They cannot say, they say they are people of love, but we claim we have love because we love all. We love them all, and we don't distinguish among any of them, while some people love some and they hate some. How can you say that in the name of love? We love them all. Marhaban bin Nabi al-Salih wal-Akhi al-Salih. La tufarriqu bayna ahadin. وقالوا سمعنا وأطعنا غفرانك ربنا ولك الحمد. See the beauty of Islam? I don't want to go any further. You already know. You can deduce. Little bit by little, you take it. Now, Allah صلى على رسول الله. صلي على نبينا.
صلي على محمد.
again to Sayyidina Yusuf Jamal, they say they make an example of Jamal and Yusufi. Huh? Jamal Yusufi is unbelievable. So they cut the people, you know the ayah? They cut their hands when they saw the beauty of Yusuf alayhi salam. They cut their hands because his beauty overtook them. But don't, you already know, huh? This is the Jamal al-Yusufi. Al-Jamal al-Muhammadi is even greater. Al-Jamal al-Muhammadi is even greater. And some people think, then how come we have no narration or hadith that the Sahaba cut their hands when they saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but the people cut their hands when they saw Yusuf alayhi salam? I say because al-Jamal al-Muhammadi was coupled with lots of jalal. So the people were overtaken by the Jamal with lots of Jalal that made them stick there like a tree in front of him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not moving as if birds were on their heads. And by Allah, had Allah removed some of that Jalal, they would have, people would have taken knives and put it in their hearts, not in their hands. They would have cut their hearts instead. Not their hands. That Jamal al-Muhammadi. Lakin, he sees Yusuf after that. You all know, you don't know that. I told you, Isra Mi'raj, we need 3 months to talk about it. Lakin, he goes after that to the fourth heaven. He sees Harun, fifth heaven. He sees Musa, seventh heaven. He sees Ibrahim alayhi salam. So here, there is a nukta here. There is Hafiz Ahmad bin Hajar Asqalani rahmatullahi alayhi wa sallam. He says, what is the point? Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala arrange only those sets of prophets to meet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in heavens? And why only Adam, Yahya wa Isa, Yusuf, Idris, Harun, Musa, Ibrahim? Why are those people? Hajar says there is two reasons. Number one, those prophets were tortured severely by their people. Severe hardships. They underwent a severe hardship with their people. He says that's one, but maybe for another reason. Why? He said because every single one of those prophets had to abandon his home and then come back to it, return back to it later. Had to do hijrah and then return back to it later. Every single one of them. How come Adam? Where was his home? Al-Jannah. He left it and then he came back. Adam. Then Yahya wa Isa. Also, they left their home. You know what happened to Yahya and Isa? And then he will come back and he will go also to Jannah. And then you have, you have Yusuf alayhi salam. Yusuf abandoned his home with his father. Went to Egypt and then after tens of years he came back. He had the opportunity to go back to it. Musa alayhi salam left Egypt and did hijrah and then came back. Every single prophet that he met did hijrah from his original home and then was allowed to return only years after that, as if this is an introduction to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that number one, you will undergo severe difficulty with your people and you have to do hijrah and you will be allowed to return again. Do you see the point? No, it's an important point to make. After that, he goes to As-Sama al-Sabi'ah. He sees Ibrahim alayhi salam, Abu al-Anbiya. He is resting, he is putting his back to Al-Bayt al-Ma'mur, like the Kaaba. There, Sayyidina Ibrahim says, As-Salaamu Alaikum, says, Ahlan bin Nabi Salih wal Ibn Salih. You are the pious prophet, the pious son. He says, Ya Muhammad, look at this. Aqra' ummataka minni salam. It's sahih. He says, tell your ummah from me salam and tell them, there is an SMS now. Message from whom? Ibrahim alayhi salam. He's sending a message to me and you. He's sending a message. He says, Aqra' ummataka minni salam. Send, tell your ummah from me salam and I have a message for them. What's the message, Ya Nabi Allah Ibrahim? He said, tell them, Al-Jannah turbatuha tayyiba. The Jannah has fertile soil. وماءها عذب. And very nice, very good water, very sweet water. غراسها, the plants, the trees in Jannah. سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر. You know what he's telling you? I don't have to tell you that. I don't have to spell it out. Why? He's telling you, please start decorating your home in Jannah. Everyone has a home. Every one of the mu'mineen has a home and a house in Jannah. Start planting some trees. How do you plant the trees in Jannah? By simply saying, Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wa Allahumma ya salam. How beautiful. You say this on the other tree. And you know what it means, right? The more trees you have, the bigger land you have. Over there, you get more by making more dhikr, not by having more money. So the only thing you can get more land is by saying Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wa Allahu Akbar. Now everybody, congratulations, you want to be in Jannah. Under your name, wallah, under your name, now there's a tree in Jannah waiting for you. Then let's make two more, just to make it higher. Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wa Allahu Akbar. You will get, don't worry, you get the deed and all these contracts, inshallah. In Jannah, inshallah. Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah. Allah. The dhikr Rabbil Alameen. Even if there was no trees, the dhikr by itself is Jannah. Even if there's no trees. We are not greedy in the trees as much we are greedy in the treat of Allah. We want treats, not trees. We want to be close to his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah. Not the trees, but he gives us the trees, he is generous, kareem, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, so he tells him this, al-bayt al-ma'mur, al-hadith says 70,000 angels, 70,000, enter this house and they do not leave it until the day of judgment. How many angels? 70,000 every day. Every day 70,000 after 70,000 after 70,000 till the day of judgment from the beginning of the creation. You see how great this universe is? How insignificant the human is who thinks he walks on with arrogance. Who are you? 70,000 angels they make tawaf around that Bayt al-Ma'mur. Every single day after 70, after 70, after 70,000. And some human beings who are compared to this universe, subhanAllah, nothing. And they walk with arrogance on earth. The hadith, if we can take something from the hadith, so it can shows you humility, humbleness in front of this great creation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made. Huh? They walk with humbleness. Tawadu. Humility. Huh? Not walk with arrogance. لا تمشي في الأرض. إنك لن تخلق الأرض ولن تبلغ الجبال طولا. Do not walk with arrogance on earth, the ayah mentions, في سورة لقمان, because you are not going to dig earth, nor are you going to be equal to the mountains. Who are you? Huh? لكن الإنسان سبحان الله كفور. ضعيف. Ungrateful. كفور means you're ungrateful. Ungrateful to the نعمة of Allah. Now, anyway, among the things, before we finish, we have 5 minutes. How many minutes do we have? 10 minutes. Khair, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. He, al-Nabi al-A'zam, let's run quickly. Al-Nabi al-A'zam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah shows him al-Jannah. And sometimes you say, why didn't he just describe Jannah? But sometimes, because your imagination can't even conceive, he says, فِيهَا مَا لَا عِينٌ رَأَتْ. An eye has not seen, وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ, an ear has never heard, وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ, and things that have not even touched a human imagination. That's the Jannah. And then he also saw a nar, وَلِيَدُ بِاللَّهِ. And a nar, Nabi al-Azam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, described it as, has 70,000 edges. And every zimam, edge, and every edge is held by 70,000 angels. Look at this.
They're holding it as if the edge, like it's something, the fire is in something, and the angels are holding it from everywhere, as if they're holding so it doesn't spill, because if it spills, it'll burn everything.
وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ.
This is what the Nabi Muhammad Then he goes, you all know, to where? From a seventh heaven, he goes to Sidratil Muntaha. Up to this point, who was with him? His Rafiq, his company,
Jibreel.
Until that point. Then no more Jibreel. But I want to stop, because I know you know the major events. So I'm not going to talk about the major events. I'm going to talk about the events that people don't talk about. No, that's what I promised you at the beginning. The point here, does that mean something? Does that tell you that you did that point saying that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was accompanied by someone? On this great journey, he was accompanied by Jibreel. On the other great journey of migration, he was accompanied by Abu Bakr. Does that ring a bell? Radiallahu ta'ala. Does it tell you that you have to find a good companion whenever you take a journey, and life by itself is a journey? Does it tell us a point that we have to have a companion in our journey to Allah, and you have to be careful what kind of companion you have? Therefore, Imam Mu'tallah al-Sakandari rahimahullah in his hikam, he says, لَا تَسْحَبَنَّ مَنْ لَا يُنْهِضُكَ حَالُهُ وَيَدُلُّكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ مَقَالُهُ. Do not accompany those he whose hal does not lead you to Allah and whose words do not direct you to Allah. Be careful, because some people, their companions will take them to Jahannam or Isa Masir. يوم يعضون الآية يوم يعض الظالم على يديه يقول يا ليتني اتخذت مع الرسول سبيلا. Then what does he say? يا ليتني لم اتخذ فلانا خليلا. الظالم, the ayah tells us that he will be biting his hand in Jahannam, saying, I wish I went with the mu'mineen, with those who follow the messengers. I went through their path. يَا لَيْتَنِي لَمْ أَتَّخِذْ فُلَانًا خَلِيلًا. I did not befriend. I wish I did not have the company of such and such person. Because they destroyed me. They ruined me. It's too late. Look around you for your friends. Look what kind of friends you have. Look what kind of friends your sons have. What kind of friends your daughters have. What kind of friends your brothers and sisters have. Give them advice, because it's important. The friend may lead you to Allah, may lead you to Ar-Rahman, or may lead you to a shaytan. I will mention one more thing also. With Musa alayhi salam, we all know when Nabi sallallahu alayhi salam goes back and forth with Musa alayhi salam, and the prayers were 50, salah 50 times. Imagine now, we have fard to pray 50 times a day. Allah, what prayer? This is 28. Which one? This one? This one is 29. 34, 35, 50 times. You cannot pray. It's the fard. Allah orders you, you have to pray. Does it show you something? That the beginning of this deen is a mercy. You don't have to pray 50. You will pray 5 and we will give you the reward of 50. What kind of deen is this? Subhanallah. What kind of mercy is this? What kind of ease is this? What kind of blessings are these? Countless. You only have to pray 5 times and we'll give you the reward of 50. This is also carries a warning for those who are slacking sometimes. Careful, if we had to pray 50, you are praying only 5. Make sure you hold on your salah. Make sure that not 5 at least. Don't be ungrateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only 5 you give. Inna salata kanat ala al-mu'minina kitaban mawquta. Timely order. It's a time. Don't. As salah is so important that it is the only ibadah that was mandated in fi sidrat al-muntaha. Everything else was revealed. But as salah. Revealed from Quran, order wahi. As salah was there. Fil mi'raj. to show you how important it is, extremely important. As-salah, salah, connection between the slave and his Lord. You sever that connection, you are disconnected from your Lord. One more thing also, the situation, the status of Musa alayhi salam. Musa, what does he do? He tells the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, says, Ya Rasulullah, go back and ask your Lord Khafif to make it, to reduce it a little bit, because I know how people are. Go back and ask, do you see what I'm saying? Do you see what I'm seeing or not? Do you see that Sayyidina Musa loves us? How much he, Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, he loves the Ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He cares. He didn't have to do that. He could have just said, you know what, it's not my Ummah, I don't care. لا, he cares. He cares about every single one of us. He cares about the Ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He told him, Ya Rasulullah, please do this. Please do this. Go and ask for this. Go and ask for this. Sayyidina Musa is showing us, even if it's, you're not part of the whole thing, you need to positively contribute. You need to positively show your input. You as Muslims now in this country and in every country, you need to positively contribute to where you are. You need to show the people the mercy of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You need to show people that you are the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Therefore you care. Therefore you care. And therefore you genuinely care. Not only about the well-being of you and your children, but the well-being of whole humanity. Because this is the message of Muhammad Rasulullah. Because وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. I will finish my 5 minutes. Am I done? Okay, fair. Just give me 1 minute, inshallah, and then I'll finish with this because I can't leave without mentioning As-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came back and he says, my bed was as warm as when I left it. He was troubled. He came back troubled. We think that he should be very happy for this ikram, but he came troubled. Umm Halik saw him in the morning. He said, Ya Rasulullah, what's wrong with you? Why do you look so worried? He says, Ya Umm Halik, this is exactly what happened to me. You think what will happen? What will the people say? She says, Ya Rasulullah, please do not tell them. If you tell them, then they will mock you, they will insult you, they will say things about you. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa left the house. And like this qada, the first one who sees him, Abu Jahl. Abu Lahab, you know the clan, Abu Lahab, Abu Jahl. May Allah save us from the Lahab and the Jahl. And the Lahab and Jahl are close. He says to him, what is wrong with you, Muhammad? Why do you look like this? He says, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he can't hide it, he just tells it. He says, this is exactly what happened to me. He says, hold, let me call everybody. He called everybody, he says, come, see what he says. He tells him like it is. Then the people, some say, some cover their eyes, some cover their heads, some start smiling. What's wrong with this man? They said, if you are saying the truth, then describe to us how Bayt al-Maqdis looks like. Then the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam start describing to them Bayt al-Maqdis as if he's the one who made it. As if he's the one who built it. He described to them, they say this description is right, but because he knows it, because this is the sihr of Muhammad. This is the magic of Subhanallah. They go to As-Siddiq radiallahu anhu and said, Ya Abu Bakr, look what your companion says. He says, what did he say? He said that he went to Al-Qudus and then he went to the heavens. He says, إِن كَانَ قَالَ فَقَدْ صَدَقْ. If he said it, he says the truth. He did not say, are you sure? He did not say, are you sure you heard him right? Are you sure you understood him right? Are you sure that's what he meant? He said, if he said it, then he has said the truth. That's why he is As-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us this tasdeeq so we can be the followers of As-Siddiq. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi wa sallamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thank you.